Hello, everyone. I'm Todd from Zemanta, CEO and co-founder, and hopefully I will leave you here today with a little bit better understanding of native in a programmatic world or the rise of programmatic native. I will say I see some people with cameras who want to take pictures. Don't worry. All you have to do is email me, todd@zemanta.com, two Ds. I will email everyone who wants a copy of this presentation. So don't feel like you have to take a picture of every slide. I'm happy to email copies of this. I can talk about programmatic native and what it is. Zemanta is a DSP for native and beyond. We started out really as the first DSP for native advertising or programmatic native. At the original OpenRTB programmatic native specification committee meeting back in late 2014, early 2015, we were the only DSP to show up. We were kind of surprised, but it was certainly something that we've been a part of since the beginning and helped define what we now define as what programmatic native is today. And I'll talk a little bit about what that actually means in a little bit. But first, I want to kind of talk about how we think about native and what it means and why, to a large extent, we believe native is the future of advertising. So we have this world that we're used to, and we're all part of digital, the idea that in the world of broadcast, interruption advertising is the norm and what we're used to as viewers, as users, but is not the world that I think is coming, and a world that I think we all believe would be better if we didn't have to either interrupt either the screen in terms of television and the program, but also interrupt the visual perception of what's going on a page. Interestingly enough, even if we weren't worried about what we felt like with regard to TV advertising, the challenge is no one's watching traditional linear TV anymore. The bottom cohort, 12 to 17-year-olds, minus 51%, 18 to 24-year-olds, minus 51%. So as you're talking to whether it's yourselves in a company trying to influence the marketing plan and spend and move spend around to where it needs to go, if you're in an agency trying to convince clients, they can put their head in the sand. But the reality is the world's changing for advertising, and the idea that dollars don't need to shift is one that's pretty foolhardy at this point. The other thing that you're starting to see is the rise of other formats and other channels. In this example, you're seeing streaming audio, and really what this means is digital is now the most popular form of audio consumption. So for certain age segments, TV is now online. For audio, certain age segments is online. So all these traditional channels that your companies or your clients have been used to, sorry, but they're going away in the way that you could spend dollars in the past. So what's also happening, unfortunately, we're moving it all to digital, but there's this thing called an ad blocker, which, crap. I want to move all, I've convinced everybody to move all their dollars to digital, but now the ads aren't getting seen anyway. Just out of raise of hands, you're all ad people. How many of you have ad blockers installed? Yeah, that's about half, right? That's pretty, and you're people who willingly accept and understand the role of advertising. So imagine regular cohorts. So this is something, a phenomenon that we're having to deal with. And fundamentally, I work for a company Zemanta is owned by Outbrain, which is a native advertising company. And they work with publishers, and ads are getting blocked. And I think we all believe that publishers could do a better job of presenting ads and making money. I want publishers to make money. And so this is a problem that we have to deal with. And it's sort of the idea that how do we make advertising a better experience? And what's interesting is I think actually programmatic, and especially programmatic native, is going to be a mechanism to get that done. Now, for those of you, are most of you experienced with programmatic, like display and traditional digital programmatic? Is that fair? If you feel like you're fairly experienced with programmatic? Okay, so it's about a third of the audience. For those of us who are in the programmatic world, the reality is, I think most people view programmatic as kind of the bottom of the barrel of online advertising. Like, you're buying remnant, you're buying ads nobody else wants to buy direct. It's sort of that perception. And I think part of my job today is to convince you that that's actually going to be wrong for the way it's going to fix advertising online, and kind of talk about how programmatic native actually helps solve for this problem ultimately. So I think you're familiar with this icon, popular on YouTube and other video sites. 70% of people who watch video ads online hit this, when it's available, hit this button. I think the only people who don't forget that it's there and are looking elsewhere. And so this is, even as we get into better ad formats potentially, this is still a problem. So I didn't block the ad, but now I'm given the opportunity to skip it. And what do? They skip it. So we got to think harder about what is the online advertising experience and what it means and how we convince or work both publishers and users to accept advertising as part of the reasonable fabric of the web. So this is probably the reality of most readers, and I see a head shaking off to my left, your right, going, exactly, right? I can't wait to get rid of this ad. I can't wait to make it go away. And the reason that's the case is, who here thinks they do a good job of creating or presenting or working with publishers to present ads that aren't annoying? I think I do, but all right, we have two more brave hands in the back, three or four, awesome. I think those of us who here in the industry wishes that when they went to a cocktail party, they didn't have to kind of fake what they were, when they had to tell their friends or new colleagues or acquaintances what they did for a living, right? Like, I work with online ads. I don't necessarily brag about that at cocktail parties, unless I want someone to walk away from me. The idea then is, what's really interesting though, is what's starting to happen with online publishing. So we have this problem of ads are annoying, they're getting blocked, the traditional ads aren't working anymore for large advertisers as people shift their behaviors. And what's fascinating is this idea that feeds are a part of the web experience. That's the important takeaway from this slide, is publishers are moving in this direction, they're reacting to Facebook, they're reacting to the idea that I'm gonna see content. And on a mobile device, you don't necessarily go to the next page, you just scroll up. You scroll left or right, you scroll up, but you don't click next. And I think that's an important understanding. And in that environment, is there a top or a bottom? There's a top of the page, there's not a bottom of the page, so where the hell do my ads go? I don't have a bottom of the page to stuff that ad anymore, and I gotta think differently about where my ads are. And if I have to think differently about my ads are, then they have to appear in that thing, that feed of content. And if it's an annoying blinking thing, I'm just gonna figure out how fast I can scroll it up. So how do I get people to stop and look at what I want them to look at? So part of that is this idea of native ads, and native ads are really just things that look like they're native to the site that they're on. That's why we use the word native. And what's interesting is what a lot of people think native ads are versus, or what they were versus what they are today, are different. Most people think what native ads are, just entirely, what their perception is, what my parent company is kind of known for, the thing at the bottom of the articles that says other things you might want to read. Kind of clickbaity things, image, sort of things that want you to click. And or they're the things in the Facebook feed that are a lot of viral publishers promote and so forth. But they're things that are kind of what native ads started at, but not where they are today, where it's this idea that they're moving away from the thing at the bottom of the page, because that's gone away because it's mobile. They're moving into this feed, this content, which means they really have to start looking like what's around that. And what's also started to happen is, as publishers now are using more and more of these feeds, they're opening themselves up. They're beginning to say, I can't be just this rigid 728 by 90 banner because nobody's looking at a desktop anyway. My inventory has to evolve and what I present has to evolve. And so part of the message of today is the ads you're working with today online are going to be very different tomorrow. And if you look at what publishers are doing and where this is going, look at your mobile device in a browser. I saw a VC post something online from Andreessen Horowitz, one of the largest, best VC firms in the world. And they were advising startups to stop making mobile apps because distribution and downloads are too expensive. They're now advising companies and startups to focus on mobile web. So again, the mobile web feed is what's starting to emerge. And what's also interesting is what happens is the business models about how you're going to transact those ads start to evolve. Where what's interesting is native ads have actually been around for a long time. Google search ads are native ads. You buy them on a CPC. Facebook ads are a native ad. You buy them on a CPC. And so what's starting to happen is, and native ad networks started by selling on a CPC. So what's starting to happen is you start transacting these ads, your business models of what they're doing are going to evolve, and suddenly some ads will have text, some ads will have images, some ads will be sold in CPC, some in CPM. So you're going to see a diversity of placements, a diversity of business models, and a diversity of ways to access that. So what programmatic really means is I no longer have to transact through a phone call, an email, or fax, or an I.O., but I have different ways of accessing through technology how I get access to a site and ultimately to a potential customer, the reader on the other side. So I've talked about this, and the reality of digital ad spend outside of Facebook and Google is it's largely banner ad driven. This is the picture of the very first banner ad from 1994, from Wired magazine called Hotwired.com at the time. And I think we'd all agree that, like, if we thought this would take over the world, we'd look back and kind of chuckle. And what's interesting is that this decision, that it was a banner ad for actually AT&T. The irony is it says, have you ever clicked your mouse right here? It says you will. Of course, the irony now with click-through rates and banner ads is no one ever does anymore. Right? The stat is you have a better chance of being hit by lightning than clicking on a banner ad. I find that amusing, the you will comment. People might have clicked on the ads for a few months, but they eventually stopped. But you know, the challenge with banner ads is they created a lot of problems. This is actually probably the biggest mistake that we made with digital advertising over the last 20 years was banner ads became fixed sizes. They were these JPEG billboards. They were fixed creatives. Any one of you have ever tried to create a dynamic banner ad, how many of you feel like you hit your head against the wall 50 times in a row to get it to work the way you wanted? I heard a chuckle. Like, yes, uh-huh. Having done this myself, it's a real pain in the ass, to be fair. Now you have things like banner blindness, because users know exactly in the pages where those go. They know where not to look. We've seen the heat map studies, right, of that, where users know to avoid the top, the bottom, the right rail, the left rail. They know to focus on the middle. So we've trained them where to look and where not to. And unfortunately, within the way that they work, they're kind of easy to game. They're easy to play with. There's lots of fraud. There's lots of other issues around this. So unfortunately, the mechanism that we use to advertise in the open web, again, anything outside of the closed cycles or the closed triumvirate of Amazon, Facebook, and Google, I glued Amazon on that now. They're probably the third largest ad platform online. And so these are things that we're thinking about. And so if we're going to fix that, what would we do? Well, this is, again, I'm biased. I think programmatic native fixes a lot of the fault of display ads. And what I mean by that is that the mistake that we made in 1994 and eventually got codified in the first IAB standards that emerged in 1996, an effort led by a guy named Rich Lefferge, they fixed the banners at these fixed sizes. 468 by 60 back then, 720 by 90 eventually, and 160 by 600, 300 by 250, da 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 da. But they were these fixed images. And what was interesting is what they didn't do is go, wait a second, we have this coding language called HTML. Why don't we just use HTML as the basis for displaying ads? And so finally, in 2015, we fixed that. So what programmatic native does is it introduces for the first time a programming language into the ad itself, like the ad call. I'm sure everyone here has read the OpenRTB specification for programmatic native. I was kidding. No one's really read that, probably but me in this room. And what's fascinating about that is it fixes fundamentally this flaw, and it introduces literally HTML and CSS into an ad call, which means suddenly as a marketer, as an advertiser, you have a programming language to display ads. And if you have a programming language, you can do a lot of interesting stuff. You can code, and code means you can be flexible, and you can make things that are that have a lot of variety. You're not creating a fixed asset, you're delivering code that adapts to the environment it's in. So we kind of fix this problem with display ads. By creating code, it means we have flexibility, and we can start doing things that really, if you can code it, you can do it now. So it's a lot of interesting flexibility. So this is a bucket list item for everyone, right? You now know what a programmatic bid request looks like. I know everyone's going, yes. So on the left hand, so if you've ever wondered, this whole world of programmatic sounds like this crazy thing I'm never going to understand, no one's ever going to, so forth. The way programmatic fundamentally works is that I'm a DSP, I register with an ad exchange, and when the ad exchange gets an impression available from a publisher, they post that to the ad exchange, and the ad exchange then blasts that out to an API endpoint. So we tell them, hey, when you get an ad impression and you're looking for a bid, send me a notice using a form, basically, to this web address. And so what we get as a DSP, we get this column on the left. And what it says is here, those of you who've ever, if there's some folks who've worked in web design and developed CSS, you'll realize that this left column looks a lot like a CSS template. So suddenly, an ad call looks like a CSS, a display bid request is much smaller than this. It basically says, hey, here's the URL, here's the size, send me an ad tag, and the amount of money you're willing to pay. And it also includes a cookie ID. This, now you get into different fields where you're looking at titles and images and the size, like it says width minimum 50, height minimum 50, et cetera. And it's telling me a lot of information about what's on the page. And so my job as a native DSP, and why we're different than a traditional DSP, we have to have a CMS, a content management system, built in to deliver, not an ad tag. There are no ad tags in native. Throw away DFA. You're done. You can move on. I see a big smile, like this person's extremely excited to go get rid of DFA. Because what you do is you actually have assets. Like, you upload to our platform images and headlines and text and buttons and icons, and those get assembled dynamically based upon the ad call. And so I have to deliver. And then what happens are you get what's on the right. So this is, we deliver information, assets and information, and that gets assembled in a browser like a web page would. So this is what a programmatic native bid request looks like. For those of you who walk back in your discussions and talking about, you're going to look like a bunch of Uber geeks, the ability to talk about this in the future. So what this means, of course, for those of you who've done website design and UX work, this is the type of stuff you've dealt with in the past. And suddenly, if you're good at designing websites, you'll be good at designing ads, because they're going to have to live within websites. They're going to become pieces of a website. Effectively, what happens is a website says, hey, I've got an impression available. I need it to look like the rest of the website. Here's the code that helps me do that. Let me know what you're willing to do. And then there's a price attached to it, and the ad exchange figures out the highest bid and delivers that. What's fascinating about this, of course, is, so for those of you who aren't aware, I mentioned earlier that the ad exchange gets notified by the publisher that they have an impression available. The website or the exchange then sends that bid request to a DSP. I have 50 milliseconds. That is 100 milliseconds. So I have 50 milliseconds to respond to this. And so one of the questions I often get is, well, I thought native meant handcrafted and I had to look like the page and I had to make it, spend a lot of time designing something. The reality is, when you have 50 milliseconds to decide whether to pay for an ad impression and then deliver the right assets, no human being can do that. A machine has to. And if every ad and every page is different, because every website is different and every ad starts to look different, then I need a machine to decide what gets delivered. And so, in fact, the reason ads don't look like the pages they're on is because before programmatic native, no human being could possibly create enough variations. So what programmatic native solves is by introducing a programming language, by taking pieces and assembling them on the fly, is that suddenly I have a mechanism to deliver something that looks like the rest of the page, and machines solve that problem. So programmatic is actually something that fixes the problem here because it does something no human being could do fast enough. Because remember, these ads are assembled on the fly as a web page loads. I have 50 milliseconds to respond. The exchange has 100 milliseconds to give it back to the publisher. The publisher then has a second or two to make sure it renders on your browser correctly. It's a lot of stuff that has to happen. Machines are the solution to this. Programmatic just means machines. So machines are the way we're going to make ads look like the rest of the page and look like they belong on the page. And if they look like they belong on the page, people get a lot less annoyed. So one of the interesting things about that, of course, is that with native, you can start doing things and being more creative, and you have more assets. You can images and headlines and combinations and so forth. Dynamic creative optimization suddenly is built into this protocol and built into the what we do, because we have multiple assets. I can deliver multiple images. I can decide amongst among many images, different headlines and so forth, and the combinations. Five images plus five headlines plus five descriptions plus five icons. Five times five times five times five, that's 625 ad creative combinations. It's a lot. How many of you have 625 creative combinations in every ad campaign you've ever run online? I don't see a single hand. Right? If you're lucky, you have five. So what this does is you certainly have these components and pieces and so forth. And so this is the key behind native and programmatic native, is this idea that I've got a lot more flexibility. The fundamental technology is a lot more flexible, and I have the ability to ultimately take advantage of that. And by the way, what's fascinating, of course, is that any digital piece of content can be turned into an ad. I just need assets, and then they can get turned into ads. So what's fascinating then, of course, I mentioned these all are going to look different. Every one of these red boxes is a native ad. Do any two of them look identical? Nope. They're unique, and they're uniquely defined by a publisher. And what a publisher's job becomes, it's their job to be the club manager, right? The club manager of a dance club or a discotheque, what their job is to create an environment that is cool and interesting and attracts a crowd. And if you're a cool person, do you pay to be a part to go into the club? Nope. The club manager knows if I get the right 50 people in the door, the next 500 will pay. Well, think of an advertiser as the cool people are the readers at the website. And to an advertiser, you're the person who's paying behind those 50 people in line at a club. So a publisher's job becomes my job to figure out how do we get a bunch of cool kids to show up so that someone else is willing to pay the cover charge to be in as part of the club, to be a part of the crowd. They want to hang with the cool kids. And so what they're doing is effectively saying, hey, my job as a publisher is to get a crowd, and then you as the marketer want to hang out with my crowd. And if you want to hang out with my crowd, you got to, like, if you go to a club and you're wearing the wrong clothes, are you allowed to come in? Nope. The bouncer says, sorry, full. And then three more people are let in right behind you. You're like, wait a second. It's because I'm wearing the wrong clothes. I look wrong. I am wrong or whatever. And effectively, right, the publisher's job is to create ad formats, right? Create the right look and feel that people want to hang out with that. And your job as a marketer then is to respect that. And sometimes you'll fit, and sometimes you won't. And it's okay, because do you want to be in a place where you're not going to be accepted? Of course not. But so this is the job of where programmatic native, then you're creating environments. The publisher's there, they're creating environments that you can participate in, and you're not going to get blocked because you're not annoying, because you fit in with the crowd. What that means, it could be images, it could be text, it could be whatever, but the publisher's job is to figure out what that is. What's interesting as a part of this is with this world of native is suddenly everything's not fixed anymore. If suddenly I've got code and pieces, then suddenly what happens are you can start doing a lot more things. Ads are no longer fixed. Someone can come to me with a product feed, a Google shopping feed, and we can turn that into ads. I can take an RSS feed and turn that into ads. I can take a web page and turn that into ads. And so you're like, the idea that I can do a lot of different things is now a possibility. Basically, if you as a marketer think it would be cool to do X, Y, and Z, the cool thing about the programmatic native and the underlying specification is, again, it's code, is I can probably do it. So suddenly, if you can dream it, there's probably a way to do it. And that's kind of the message here, is that this is just an example of how people are now doing different things with this world of native and turning different ideas into ads. And a good example is you can do product listing ads in native. It's not no longer to Google Shopper. Criteo is basically just turning display ads into native ads. They're turning native ads. They're using product listing ads and retargeting in native ads. They plug into backends like mine to buy ads in the native space because they have product feeds. Interesting things, of course, is that you're now going to see carousel ads. Again, this is like the world of native is where all the cool new things are happening. Product ads now and ad placements inside publishing pages, carousel ads. You're going to start to see video ads. You're going to have things like interactive ads. And so what that means is you're no longer fixed in what you want to do. And by the way, it's not expensive. You don't have to hire a dev team and spend $250,000 to do some hack of a flash thing that kind of works in some placements and generally crashes people's browsers, and people like Steve Jobs show up one day and ban Flash. And so what's fascinating is you have this opportunity, again, you're going to have a way to do things. You have flexibility in what you can present. And I think that's one of the key messages about where what's happening in programmatic native is if you're interested in doing something new and different, there's a way to do it programmatic. Like every one of these ads you can buy programmatically. Everything I'm showing you here can be bought programmatically. This is not go try to buy a carousel ad in a display DSP in exchange. Good luck. Not happening, right? Again, five. I got five. 720 by 90, 300 by 60, 160 by 600, etc. That's it. If you dream it, you can do it. That's what also gets exciting. Native includes video, outstream, in feed, etc., in article. That's all native. And what's fascinating is some of the metrics that you start to see around this in terms of how much more cost-effective it is than some other types of native. This is where you're going to get unlocked and get outside YouTube and get into environments. Some of these video ads are click-to-play. Some are autoplay, like Facebook style, where you mouse over and it plays audio. You have that flexibility. So here's some of the metrics that start to show up. And you can see, oh, this is pretty cost-effective. This is pretty interesting. I could do things in a lot of different environments. I'm not just stuck in YouTube or Facebook to do some of these things. What's also starting to happen is native to display. So some publishers don't have native ad slots yet, as much as I wish they would. And what's fascinating is that we have marketers who work with us and others, and they don't have, they've stopped making display ads. And so what we've started to do is you're starting to see the ability of like, well, you know what? That's just HTML assets. I can format that for display ads. You're going to start to see, even in traditional placements, native ads start replacing traditional digital display ads. Again, a lot more flexibility. DCO built in. Has the ability to flexible work across all publishers and placements then. And I'm no longer just limited to even native placements. I can now take advantage of these across the web. So I've hopefully sold you on native as the best thing since sliced bread. It's cool and interesting. Lots of innovations happening in terms of formats and placements and publishers and what have you. You're ready to go out and spend all your money in native. And you're ready to go knock on Google's door. Not the best door to knock on. In fact, these are just some of the ad exchanges that my DSP is integrated with. And so what's interesting is the supply is different. The exchanges are different. It's a new world order. Some traditional DSPs are starting to add some native functionality. Generally, they don't integrate with as many of this. I think I've got the largest integrated supply network around the world. And so that's something, as you look at this, is who are the partners? What are the challenges? One of the challenges is there's lots of native exchanges. A lot of native ad networks have turned themselves into exchanges. something like my job is to integrate with them and make them easy and allow you the ability to transact anywhere. And again, you'll start to see other DSPs add more and more of these supply partners. But the key difference here, it's not just a world of if you buy display, you can buy it all in AdX. That's not the world of native. So ask questions about the platforms you're working with, who they're integrated, what they're working with. What's fascinating, of course, every one of these native exchanges has different specifications. They're all slightly different. They work with different publishers, different types of placements. Some are more flexible, some are more rigid, some have the cool new carousel ads, some have videos, some don't, some have playable, some don't, right? So part of the world here is it's a bigger world to get your hands around, but there are at least people like me, and there are others, who can help answer the questions on where do I run, how do I run, and how do I make this happen? So what's fascinating, of course, then is, okay, I'm now running native campaigns, I've got campaigns live, and so do I just run it like a traditional display campaign? Is that how I report on it and analyze it? Sorry, your world's changed again. The percentage of view, my cost of reach per viewable impression against defined target audience doesn't work anymore. The good news is it actually works in a better way. Remember I mentioned native ads are bought in a CPC? People still click on it. I see CTRs and ad placements that get in the single digits, like not 0.6, not 0.01, 3, 4, 5%. Not clickbaity ads, like normal brands, normal types of ads. So what starts to happen then, if you're a platform like ours, we're worried about, will the user, is it the right placement for the right creative? Will it generate a click? And then we then have to worry about this thing called post-click performance. Because remember, no one clicks on a banner ad, so we stop worrying about that, stop reporting on it. We now have things like view conversions. I mean, it is what it is. I think it's kind of a silly metric, but if no one's clicking, I need to do something to report on it. But imagine a world where you can report on whether someone actually does something that just sees it. So platforms like ours in the native world, we worry about post-click engagement. Will they click, and then will they stick around and actually do something after the fact? What's fascinating, the way that we work as we do this is, we actually look at Google Analytics and Adobe Analytics data. We actually plug that right into our platform and can like report on metrics like cost per minute of engagement, cost per page view, cost per non-bounce visit, kind of cool metrics. Those of you on the client side, and or agencies who work with clients, how many of your users, of yourselves or your clients, log into Google Analytics or Adobe Analytics versus log into an ad dashboard? If you raise your hand, if you think every one of your user of your customers or colleagues logs into your web analytics in the marketing department, like I think everyone does. Got some hands. And if I asked you to raise hands, like how many of you actually have logged in or looked at a report of like an ad buying dashboard, it'd be like zero. Tell me a CMO is logged into. I'm getting a good handshaking here. No CMOs ever logged into an ad buying dashboard. Every one of them has seen a report out of a Google Analytics or Adobe Analytics. Imagine you can, like, you know what happens when you buy ads that result in clicks on the, they show up in web analytics reports. Suddenly, what you do is no longer this buried, hidden thing over here where you're kind of reporting on some metrics. Suddenly, you have the ability to report on things that actually happen. So the buying changes. You actually have to report on what happens and create things that influence what happens. So you know what's amazing is context drives performance. So why do we exist? We exist because we drive better performance. The other DSPs include DV360, Trade Desk, AppNexus, et cetera. 2 to 5x better CTR, because we worry about things like click, better CPCs. We exist because we figured out how to work with ads that drive performance, that drive click-through, and drive CPCs. And so these are the things that start to matter and why people always ask, well, do I need another DSP? And our answer is, unfortunately, we think so, because remember that supply, it's all different. The formats are all different. You have to figure out how to bid on those things. Machine learning algorithms that are behind all this bidding and what have you have to get trained on more than 5 formats, infinite publishers and formats. So here's the metrics of the programmatic native world for the last 30 days. This is across our entire platform. To the far right column, we see 113,000 unique publishers. That's, we think, the population of publishers that are commercially viable running native ads that would make that available programmatically. The average CPC is 17 cents. It's across mobile and desktop. It's about 65% mobile traffic, 35% is desktop when it comes to the world of native. The average CPM of the ads bought is 53 cents. CTR of 0.3, post-click bounce rate of 78%. That's pretty much normal, right? It's not clickbaity ads. These are real ads delivering real performance. I mean, the average bounce rates I see in web pages is right around 80%, so that's pretty right on par. Time on site, 45.5 seconds post-click. These are ad-driven time on sites. That's actually higher. Average website that I see is around 25 seconds, I mean. So we're delivering better engagement through people who came through a paid ad than people who show up organically. It's kind of interesting. And then I mentioned you could do things like average cost per minute. What's fascinating around this is that that's a metric. If you work for a CMO, brand scorecards, all of them have cost per dollar of engagement as a metric that drives brand scorecards. Because when they spend money in marketing, what they're trying to do is get touches, trying to get in front of consumers. So suddenly you have a metric that's driven by digital ad dollars that feeds into a brand scorecard. That's kind of cool. And how do you make digital advertising relevant and more important to an organization, especially a traditional organization? These are the metrics that help do that. Quickly going to run through some case studies. This is an example of some of the brands. Monistat, a lot of pharmacy OTC products work through native. You're seeing example of the type. Sometimes they have descriptions, sometimes they don't. You're seeing the type of CTRs. This is from a live campaign. 1% click-through rate on a woman jogging. Pretty cool, right? Like, how many of you would jump up and down and do cartwheels who've bought digital ads if you had 1% CTR? 6.4 cents CPC, average cost per outbound visit, which is the metric they were using, was $1.36. I think their target was about $5. So this is, I can deliver pretty meaningful performance. Now, the key of this is they found great publishers to work with, great context, a lot of mommy blogging sites in the US, but this is the type of stuff that can drive real performance. That's not a very clickbaity ad, is it? But that's the type of stuff people think native is this clickbaity stuff that's for viral publishers, but the reality is it's brands and you can drive real performance and results with this type of real world content. We also see automotive brands. What's fascinating about this actually is, and the reason I'm including this is, how traditional metrics would have led to the wrong result. So again, the focus here was cost per outbound visit. Their target was a dollar. What's interesting here is most campaigns that are digital, programmatic campaigns, are focused on buying the lowest CPM. If I had done that, the 37 cents, my cost per outbound visit would have been 48 cents. Still had a goal, but the lowest and best performing was 22 cents, 2.5x lower performance if I'd focused on a traditional metric. Instead of focusing on the end metric, the post-click metric that really was what they were after. The other thing is you see time on site and other metrics that if I could focus on a lowest CPC, if I picked the third one, I would have spent more money on that. Again, a lower performing ad. And how do campaign? What do they look like when you can actually pick the result and the creative that drives the results that you want? And different things end up winning. You're seeing spend across all that just as this is from our platform, how spend starts. Gets average and then ultimately invest in the winner. This is eventually a campaign where 89% of the spend ended up on the first one. The other thing is you notice CPM 95 cents. In a traditional programmatic campaign, that would have not have won, would have been dropped, and it turns out to be the best result in terms of driving post-click performance. Things that we thought were obvious aren't as obvious when you actually get to see what happens after the click. Another thing that's popular and starts to show up in the world of native is the ability to do earned media and retargeting. I can promote articles. I don't have to just even have, like, if I don't have ads, you know what you can do is you can find some news article about your company or product and promote that. And what they do is that the way this works is that a click happens, goes to a redirector, we can cookie them and retarget them. And so suddenly you have the opportunity to get really cost-effective campaigns in terms of driving things that really work. So this is a two-step strategy. Again, more creative strategies. I can do things that I might not have been able to do. I can take advantage of things that happen in the real world, promote them, and then turn them into a targeted campaign. Again, kind of some of the same strategies we're used to. Retargeting works great, right? We all, I think, have learned that. But now I can kind of evolve that and look at some of the next generation strategies that are coming. This is becoming increasingly popular, especially for consumer-oriented products, where I can take advantage of great earned media and turn that into something that drives a traditional campaign. You can see the examples of the metrics around the earned media promotion, 23 cents per click, and then the retargeting clicks weren't more expensive. They were less expensive after that. Not a traditional display, programmatic display, that's not necessarily always the case. Usually it's the opposite. First click is less expensive. Second or third clicks are more expensive. This is really a fascinating sort of result. So that's sort of the story to walk away from today, which is the world is changing. Publishers are having to react to the fact that the users don't want to see ads the traditional way. They're trying to do a better job. They're trying to make their experiences better and less annoying and less so you don't use ad blockers, because if they don't, ads are going to get blocked. Marketers have an opportunity to take advantage of this new world order. And what's really nice is it's interesting and different and new. And you don't have to do the same thing every day in, day out. You don't have to buy another 720x90 anymore. To the person who's very excited about, you don't have to use DFA, you don't have to use DFA anymore. And what's great, as we saw ultimately at the end, is that you can drive, even though it's new and different, and hopefully not as boring as it once was, you can drive meaningful results that are better than what you are doing today. Oftentimes, the new thing performs less, so better CPMs, better CPCs, better CTRs, better post-click engagement, all that driven by real-world examples. And again, we have a lot more of these examples to share. If you have specific questions, don't hesitate to come up and ask. Again, todd@zemanta.com. I'm happy to email copies of this to whoever wishes to have a copy of it. And thank you for listening.